Hello everyone, and welcome to our presidential lecture on automation of our railways. We will specifically focus today on lessons learned from automotive and the self-driving developments that are going on in that domain. And we will be looking at some of the experience that we've been gaining in recent projects in that specific sector. So to take you through some of the contents that we will be discussing today, firstly, we'll be introducing ourselves a little bit further and the work we've been doing more recently. Then we will focus on the specific goals for each sector in automation, which are a little bit different for each. We'll be looking at safety in transportation and the available figures that are related. We'll be discussing some of the challenges in automation that each sector is having. And we'll be discussing some of the solutions that we see, especially in the automotive domain, that we can leverage for our own challenges in the railway sector. And finally, we'll be leaving some room for discussion and conclusions. And we'll be eventually doing some Q&A after the session with you and the questions that you might be having for us today. So one of the statements that we have for you today, and this is how we feel after creating our paper and our lecture, is that our extreme safety standards are hindering innovation, chasing passengers into innovative cars, and increasing the total number of fatalities in total. This is something that we'll be highlighting further throughout our presentation today, and I hope that in the end you might either agree or disagree with our statement, and we'll have a discussion about this. So a little bit about the authors of the paper and the presentation today. My name is Tom Jansen. I have about 10 years, over 10 years of experience in the railway now, experience as a railway signaling engineer. And I've been working in automated driving for the past couple of years, specifically both in the railways, but actually even more in the automotive domain. And my background is in embedded electronics and complex electronic safety systems, specifically more lately in the functional safety domain and the verification of these systems. And I've been involved in several automated driving projects in the last couple of years, which include some truck platooning projects, the autonomous shuttles on Brussels airports, the Rivian Park Shuttle autonomous shuttles, some other small projects as well, and most recently the heavy rail ATO pilots that have been going on. And now I'll leave it to Rick to introduce himself.
Thank you, Tom. So my name is Rick Driessen. I'm working for Ricardo since 2017, where I currently act as a requirements engineer for a large ETMS retrofit project. Before, I was involved in several train track integration campaigns, and I wrote several safety analyses for automated people movers. Back to you, Tom.
Thank you, Rick. So now a little bit about our experience in automated vehicles in the recent years. So as I already explained briefly, we have been involved in quite a few projects in the automated vehicle domain, both in the railways and also in the road sector. So some examples that have been in commercial use, for example, are the Ultra PST system in London Heathrow, the Masdar system in the Emirates, and there's examples of developments in truck platooning that we've been working on, automated shuttles, for example, the Zaventem Airport shuttle that we've been working on. One of the first projects in the Netherlands, the WePods, was one of the projects that we collaborated on. And then one of the first projects that ever happened here was the Filias semi-automatic guided bus. Unfortunately, at that time, the safety evidence wasn't sufficient for the bus to eventually come into full commercial use, So for that statement of safety, we were unable to verify that it was safe enough to go on the road. Then very recently, we've been helping the Hague operator HTM on installing advanced driver assistance systems on their Arvania trams. And our colleagues in the UK have been working on the Thames Link, which is of course a very familiar project to most of you. So all in all, quite a few experiences with automated vehicles so far. Looking at the different sectors that are automating vehicles right now, there's a few key differences that I would like to highlight for you today. So most of you will be familiar with the automatic train operation, which has been going on for quite a while. If you look at metro systems and closed off systems, an ATO there is meant to increase capacity and reliability in the way the trains are driven, are performing. What we also see are autonomous shuttles or pods in urban environments being piloted, usually still at low speeds, but fully autonomous with no steering wheel and ultimately meant to have no driver. Currently though, there often still are stewards on board to make sure that the vehicle is performing in the way that is expected, while we gain confidence in the performance of these vehicles and their safety. Ultimately, I think these shuttles will be a great addition to public transport, for example, in the first and last mile, where buses or trams or even trains might be too expensive to operate. And we still want to offer quality service in public transport to where people actually need to be. What we also see are commercial heavy duty developments. They're automating what I like to call the dull, the dirty, and the dangerous tasks. And often there's a good business case which is leading for either less fuel or getting rid of drivers, better safety. And as long as there's a business case, they're willing to invest and make progress in innovation. So we also see, of course, the passenger car manufacturers that are innovating, usually driven from a couple of top tier manufacturers, but really everyone seems to be doing it these days. And they're upgrading their luxury passenger cars with advanced driver assistance systems, advanced lane keeping systems, for example, and the driver is still a backup in most of these systems while they develop towards full self-driving capabilities. So what you see is that each sector is really pursuing different goals, is taking a different approach, but ultimately all these vehicles are going to be automated is their vision. So now Rick will tell you something about both the past and the present of autonomous vehicles and how we see the future in the railway specifically as well.
When looking into the demand for rail transportation, we see that this is growing. We see in Europe, but also across the globe, that rail passenger transportation is growing at an increasing pace. So this figure shows us that in the EU, in 2005, we made 365 billion passenger kilometers. And 11 years later, this number was increased by a staggering 23%. What we also see is that the tracks are becoming more and more congested. Our rail network isn't able to handle the growing demand. And when forecasting the future, this will become a huge problem. But not only rail is getting more popular, the overall demand for passenger transportation is growing. Traditional modes of transportation are innovating, while complete new modes are arising. And this is influenced by several factors. For example, globalization. We want to travel faster and further. And this led, for example, to the idea of the Hyperloop, an airless pod system that one day may connect large cities. Urbanization. We want to connect cities with other cities, but we also want to provide good transportation within a city. And Airbus responded on this transition with its air taxi, a fully electrical autonomous helicopter that can pick up passengers in busy cities. And on this picture, you see its first test flight last July. Decarbonization is a hot topic. We need to become more fuel efficient and finally fully electrical. And this opened the way for Tesla and its electrical cars, which became extremely popular. Digitalizations. Nowadays, we expect real-time information on traffic and to be able to plan our train journey on our phone. And a good example how Uber responded on this transition was with this driverless taxi service, which you can request by clicking on their app. Lastly is the effect of COVID-19. This, of course, needs to be seen, but prognoses show that rail transportation will rebound quickly. And an interesting side effect of this crisis is how the demand for e-bikes exploded. And our rail system is able to meet up with almost all these criteria. Yet we see that even though demand is growing, we're falling behind the other modes of transportation. And this graph shows an estimation. In 2050, the demand for rail will increase with 114%, but the road demand will increase with 162%, and aviation evenly with 368%. So we see a growth in rail passenger volumes, but we also see a growth in congestion. And this will lead that our traditional rail systems starts falling behind other modes of transportation, traditional and innovative. Now, trains are such a good mode of transportation. Thus, we believe that the railways are facing existential threats from innovative competing transportation modes. And this will bring us to our main challenge. How can the railway industry still be competitive and attractive enough in the mobility landscape of the future? Before we're going to answer that question, I want to take you back to the past. How did the autonomous car develop, and how did the autonomous train develop, and do we see any resemblances?
Look, no hands, and no driver for that matter. Scientists assure us that it's the shape of things to come in highway travel. This robot car is the latest project under study by the Road Research Laboratory. It's all done by computerized electronic impulses relayed to the car through a special receiving unit fixed to the front. Signals picked up from the inlaid track are interpreted by the unit to change the car's course or its speed, rather similar to the automatic pilot system used in aircraft. Sometime in the future, they say, every vehicle on a main road network could be taken by remote control all the way to its destination. It may seem a bit of a pipe dream at the moment, but researchers say that robot cars may well be in everyday use within 30 years.
So this first clip showed us one of the first driverless cars in 1971. And this vehicle was guided by the infrastructure on a simple and robust way. And this is present day. A driver is entering his destination and the car is driving you there autonomously. And it took longer than 30 years and we are definitely not there yet, but Tesla shows us that we are well on our way. And we should not forget that the environment of the cars changed dramatically and roads become far more crowded. In the US, for example, in 1960, the number of registered cars was 60 million, and now it's over 250 million. Yet research shows us that autonomous cars are already more safe than their hand-driven cars. So let's focus on the railway.
The first of London Transport's automatically driven trains made its press debut. It's the type of rolling stock that will go into service on the new Victoria line when it opens shortly. One man will be in charge of each train. Once the doors are closed and the start button pressed, the train takes over, receiving all its commands through the track. Faster, smoother, and more comfortable travel is promised for London's commuters on the new line. They're already used to standing, but it won't be quite so bumpy or for so long. Holland.
So here we see the opening of the Victoria line in London in 1968. One of British first autonomous metro systems. And we see that autonomous metro systems are getting more conventional. As for example, the Sydney metro system that opened last year.
After years of promises and planning and billions of construction dollars, the Northwest Metro, dubbed the world's best, finally opened today, but not without a few teething problems. One train had to be pulled out of service while other glitches caused delays, with up to 100,000 passengers turning out to be part of Sydney's transport history.
Crowd crush at Sydney's newest stations.
Everyone just seems to be panicking trying to get back on.
All day, gates jammed with eager commuters waiting patiently.
But I got here at 6 and I was the first person here. I couldn't believe it.
Before filing in for their first taste of transport history. The Northwest Metro now officially open to the public.
Two, one, woo!
A aboard the first train from Tullawong, the first real commuters.
It's fantastic. Yeah.
It's very safe. Very safe.
A little bit speedy, dude, but yeah, it's comfortable.
We've got the best metro in the world.
A single-deck train which is going to change lives forever.
But the metro fanfare was soon marred by drama. Half-hour delays with driverless trains overshooting platforms and having to reverse.
It's been like 24 minutes by now.
Glitches with doors.
The doors opened and one of them wouldn't close for a little while.
Air conditioning too hot and too cold.
I thought there were a lot of kinks to iron out.
So it might be a bit unfair to show this video, since this metro system was delivered on time and $1 billion under budget, which is an enormous achievement. And I mentioned startup problems were quickly fixed. But we're comparing this video with the Victoria line over 50 years ago, do we really see massive innovation as we see in the autonomous industry? And while autonomous metro systems are getting more conventional, in heavy rail, automation is falling behind. We only see a handful of autonomous lines in the world and a couple of dozens of pilot projects. But why do we want to go autonomous? This question we answered in our paper. And we summarized autonomous cars are a step forward since it increases the safety of the passengers. It improves connectivity. It lets the driver use his driving time for other things. And it increases the road capacity since cars are more predictable. On the other hand, autonomous trains fulfill a different range of goals. And safety is not one of them, since trains are already relatively safe. Automation will increase the capacity of the network, which is a true issue at the moment. And by letting a computer drive, it will increase the energy efficiency of a train. Lastly, by increasing the capacity of the network, we don't have to lay a lot of new tracks anymore, which will save significant costs. So let's start with safety. Why do we want to look into safety? Not only because of the lives we lost and saved, but also because of our perception on safety alters the popularity of the train. A little bit of a theory. The risk homeostasis theory argues that people adjust their behavior based on the perceived level of risks. People have an ideal or a target level of risk and act upon them by engaging in aggressive behavior when feeling safer than their target level, and engaging in risk avoidance behavior when feeling less safe than their target level. And this is brilliantly illustrated on September 3rd, 1967 in Sweden. Because on that day, the Swedish switched from driving onto the left side of the road to the right side of the road. And the people of Sweden thought it was a very dangerous decision. Several protested against it because they expected an increase of car accidents as a result. Driving on the right side was something new. People weren't able to react and steer their cars properly, which will lead to a lot of car crashes. But strangely, the opposite happened. The number of accidents reduced significantly for the first 6 weeks. And after that, it slowly started increasing again, till in 1969, it was back on its normal level. And this shows us two things. Firstly, left-hand traffic countries can make the switch and join the majority of the world by reducing the number of traffic accidents. And this is good news for our audience from the UK and Australia. And secondly, apparently people perceive driving on the right side more dangerous. It was something new, people had no experience, and therefore they adjusted their behavior and started driving more cautious at start, because after people became more familiar with driving on the right side, they started feeling safer than the target level and they started driving riskier. This explained by the risk homeostasis theory, people can be encouraged to change their behavior and, in extension thereof, their mode of transportation based on their risk perception. Now, how safe do we perceive a train? A study in Norway shows us that the plane is perceived lowest on the probability of an accident. The train is a close second. However, the effects of a train crash are perceived to be far more dramatic than that of a train accident. And on the total risk level, probability times consequences, the train is superior amongst all modes of transportation. So people perceive the train to be very safe. But safety is not everything. The study also shows us other reasons why we choose a specific mode of transportation. Availability, ease of use, and travel time are perceived more important than the idea of safety. Yet safety is still a very important aspect. And when looking into the actual numbers of safeties, the passenger fatality rate, we see that this is decreasing steadily for over the years. So this figure shows us that within the EU, this number is less than a third it was 10 years ago. And the EU, including Norway and Switzerland, reported a rate of 0.004 passenger fatalities per 100 million passenger kilometers in 2018. In other words, one fatality occurs each 25 billion passenger kilometers. And to put this in perspective, one fatality occurs each 623,000 laps around the Earth. It's fair to say that rail is a very safe mode of transportation. And while comparing the EU with other countries, we see significant differences, but all remain within the same order of magnitude. This figure shows us the EU compared to South Korea, Australia, the United States, and Canada. And when comparing rail with other modes of transportation, we see that rail is outperforming them all. This table shows us the number of the EU that came up in 2003, and then also shows the numbers I calculated for 2018. We see that rail and air transportations are on a similar level of safety, but rail is safer. We see that rail road safety is significantly behind, with a factor of 70 or even more. And we see that the differences in perspective of safety are much smaller than they actually are. So summarizing, rail demand is growing, but a network cannot keep up with this growth. Other modes of transportation are growing even faster and use innovation to enable their growth. And rail is perceived to be very safe, and it actually is the safest mode of transportation. Yet, in the future, the share of less safe modes of transportation will grow, which will lead to unnecessary deaths. Back to you, Tom.
So, now that Rick has briefed us on the statistics of safety in transportation overall, and about the future, and also the history that's in automation in these sectors, let's have a look at what the automotive sector is currently doing in innovation and how it's performing. So we all know that innovation, and especially automation, is not without challenges. And in general, the opinion is that autonomous vehicles can be a lot safer ultimately, and that they are able to prevent a lot of accidents that we see happening on the road. And I visualized this in the graphic that you see over here, where a lot of accidents can be saved by autonomous vehicles that are happening today and are caused by what we call human error. So a lot of these things can be seen, can be solved by autonomous vehicles. But meanwhile, there's a lot of things happening already on the road today that are being caused by these vehicles, which could have easily been prevented by human drivers. And that means that these vehicles might well introduce completely new accidents that would not have been happening with human drivers on our roads today. So this is a very uncertain area of accidents that we really want to keep as low as possible. And we might still see, but eventually, of course, the goal is to save lives and to be more safe in the autonomous driving sector for the automotive. Now, some examples of what's been happening in this specific domain is, for example, the Uber crash in Arizona last March, where a jaywalking cyclist slash pedestrian was crossing the road and was not timely seen by the automated vehicle of Uber, and eventually led to a crash. Now, the reports that have been out since the crash show that one of the underlying causes was that the system was misclassifying this specific person as either a pedestrian or a cyclist or just a plastic bag. And all the while making that decision, the vehicle was delaying the emergency braking that should have actually been going on, which is very unfortunate and ultimately has led to the fatality that has been the cause of this accident. Now, what we also see are accidents that are happening that also would not have been going on with human drivers. For example, in Taiwan, where a recent Tesla Model 3 has crashed into a box truck that was flipped on the highway and was just lying there while the Tesla vehicle was approaching and could normally clearly see the box truck lying there, but still failed to brake in time and crashed into that box truck, which is a very silly accident to happen, but we do see it happening on the road maybe because of misclassification, maybe because the sensors were just not able to see the truck lying there with reflections or something like that. But these are the sorts of accidents that we could have not predicted, maybe, or at least we didn't solve currently with the state of technology. So we do see a good progress in reliability of these systems, but there's still a lot of challenges, and a lot of these challenges are around the edge cases of the technology and about making sure that we really do understand everything that we need to solve in the future. So that means that demonstrating the safety of these autonomous vehicles is especially challenging. And that's mainly caused because of all these scenarios that might be happening, all sorts of conditions that together form a specific environment for that car driving today. We might not have thought about all these conditions and might not have been able to test them all. And that's something that Dilbert here on top already realized, and maybe you're familiar with that in your own projects as well. It's usually really quite challenging to state when a project is to end and what are all the different things that you might run into that you need to solve in order to be done and be safe eventually, and well, to not cause any issues and not any accidents on the road in the case of autonomous vehicles. And especially problematic in this domain are the unknown unknowns, as we call them. And that's demonstrated here in this Rumsfeld matrix, which tells you there's all sorts of situations that we know that are out there and that we are able to program in the case of autonomous vehicles. But there's also unknown situations that we are aware of. Well, we're actually not aware of these situations, and we couldn't either program them into the vehicle because we didn't know. And in some situations, this might work out fine because we didn't really think that it might be snowing in Spain today, but the vehicle is still able to cope with it because we programmed it from some other country and it still works out fine. Good. Then we're locking up. But in some other situations, there's an unknown unknown, which means that we did not predict the situation and the vehicle isn't able to handle it either because it's so new and so remotely likely that we never figured that it would be needed to solve, and the vehicle is just not able to cope with it. And that's the specific domain where accidents are likely to happen, and that will be contributing to that one factor of new accidents. And this is a very specific challenge that is very hard to solve at this time. Now, when disengaging an autonomous vehicle, so let's say it's autonomously driven and at some point it either fails or it needs to hand back, there's three sorts of failures that are relevant here. So in one situation when a takeover was not required, so the vehicle was actually able to perform the driving itself, but it's still disengaging, it still hands over the steering wheel to the driver, that's just a false positive and poor reliability, and that's too bad, but it's not a safety issue. So no big deal for safety people, maybe for the salesperson, yeah, but no, it's not causing any issues. When you're looking at the situation where a takeover is required and a vehicle is indeed disengaging, that can be a structured handover. So it's your limits of operation, the operational design domain, as we call it, has been almost reached. So you, for example, you know that you're nearing the exit of the highway that you need to take to your home, and then the vehicle can do a structured handover back to you, and you have some time to get familiar with your environment and to take over the controls and completely do a smooth transition into automated driving, or into manual driving, and drive back to your home. The problem arises and accidents happen when takeover is required, but the vehicle doesn't disengage, it doesn't realize that it's happening, or maybe it realizes too late. And that will lead you to running into a situation that the vehicle cannot handle anymore. You were zoned out in your book and in a video that's playing in the car. And at that time, a handover is immediately needed and you will not be aware of where you're driving. You'll not be able to correct the vehicle and accidents happen. So these false negatives where the vehicle is not aware of how it might handle the situation or where it's for some reason doing the wrong thing, that's where we really see issues with automated driving. And that's the most important factor to be solving. Now, looking at how good these vehicles are actually performing, there's unfortunately very little statistics out there. What I did is I looked at the California DMV's autonomous vehicle disengagement reports for the last couple of years that are available. And this is just about the only objective data that's out there. But unfortunately, even this data is sort of flawed. What's reported here in yellow, you see the amount of kilometers per disengagement of the vehicles. That means it would have to be giving back control to the human driver, or it might be overruled by the human driver. And then in green, we see the amount of incidents that were happening. Now, to start with that one, it's not completely fair because incidents are also the ones where the autonomous vehicle would be rear-ended. So that's not completely fair for how the vehicle is performing in automated mode. But on the other hand, maybe it's doing something silly that wasn't expected by the other driver. So, well, it's at least an indication. If you look at the kilometers per disengagement, that's also not completely fair, but it's the other way around because these vehicles are driven in a sort of familiar environment eventually. It will be the same city, it will be usually good weather, it will be fine conditions for these vehicles. And of course, it's being stretched to something more challenging, but if it would be snowing and it would be icy and poor visibility, then that's going to be even more challenging for the vehicles, and these statistics will be very hard to achieve. So even if you look at the best performers out there, which in this statistic would be Waymo with about 18,000 kilometers for every disengagement, that still means that it's not nearly as good as a human driver. We're getting there, and the accident rates are sort of okay, but it's still really quite challenging. And if you look at accident rates at about 190,000 kilometers, humans only make accidents for about 800,000 kilometers on average. So still quite a while to go for these vehicles yet. And that's not even considering the companies that are performing just a little bit less out there, which also will need to get on that same level of safety that we find acceptable as society. Meanwhile, there's also practical experience with autonomous vehicles that's being gained with an increasing fleet of autonomous vehicles on the road. And for me, a recent survey among Tesla Model 3 owners shows that subtlety of that story, because quite a lot of them are actually quite satisfied with the safety of the autopilot functionality. And among them, a few drivers claim that the autopilot contributed to a collision. So that's the bad thing to happen. And also some people claim that the autopilot was saving their lives. And some good examples about that are, for example, that the vehicle would be driving on the highway at high speed and then suddenly would be braking for no apparent reason at all. So phantom braking. And that's what we actually read a lot. These vehicles are seeing a lot of false positives on the road by their sensors, for example, and they might be reading the situation differently than a human driver would be doing, and suddenly hitting the brakes very hard for no apparent reason for the driver behind you, even causing incidents for people that suddenly need to get on their brakes as well while they weren't really expecting anything to happen. So that's actually causing dangerous situations out there. Meanwhile, there's also other people that claim that the autopilot reacted crazy fast to something that happened out there and they would never have been able to handle that themselves, and the pedal was already pressed to the floor. So this tells you that story about accidents that are being saved, but meanwhile, new scenarios are happening and another type of accident is happening out there that we eventually want to be solving. And that balance is something that we need to keep track of. It needs to be the right way, at least for the automotive sector right now, because the aim is to improve safety of the vehicles. So I already explained that these unknown unknowns are very challenging for the sector, and the way that we conventionally prove safety is also struggling to do that. One of the solutions that we see to run these vehicles through all the situations, it's not in testing on our public roads. There's simply so much you need to see and to do that it would take, I believe, a fleet of 100 vehicles running 24 hours a day for 400 years to meaningfully display that it's going to be a safe vehicle. And that's just not something that we can do. And that's not even considering that the software would be changing because of updates, because of the situations that are changing out there. So the strategy that the sector is following right now is in terms of simulation. And I personally believe that we always need to pursue simulation and a properly layered demonstration of safety for that matter, because in simulation you can run through edge cases much more easily than you can in a real world environment. And what we see right now is that there's virtual validation happening with simulation suites, with tools that are able to run these vehicles and their software through all these specific scenarios and eventually prove that that vehicle was safe and has been able to go through all these test cases and edge cases specifically that we are aware of. And the more unknowns that we take away and that we are familiar with, we can run through the software of the vehicles again and ultimately demonstrate quite neatly that the software is at least capable of doing that, and then integrating that into the vehicle model and so forth with some further testing for integration. Now that we've seen what challenges apply to automation in the automotive sector, let's talk a little bit about solutions in automation that we can learn from, things that we can take to the railway sector that will enable us to innovate. One of the obvious ones, of course, is obstacle detection. It's really relevant for autonomous driving and road vehicles, and the same sensor sets sort of apply for railway vehicles as well, with some challenges and questions around that specific sensor set. Now, there are advancements already in such systems in the railways that I'm aware about, and what we see is that they're being applied to light rail vehicles in pilots and demonstrations. As already previously explained, for example, the ADAS systems for the De Haag tram system. But there's also pilots being done in France with the RATP system for Alstom, with sensor sets that allow the tram to be stabling automatically ultimately. We also see pilots in Russia, where the Lastovka train is being fitted with sensors and is able to be looking ahead and predicting the path of the train and the objects in their path to make sure that the train will be fully autonomously driven in the future. So we do see already some implementations of obstacle detection systems in the railways, luckily, and there's pilots going on to see that. I think the main challenge in the railways is in heavy rail automation and tackling all the level crossings. That is a big uncertainty currently and something we need to investigate further for the correct sensor set and how we can solve these issues. So definitely something where I think we can take knowledge from the automotive sector and where we can move ahead with more demonstrations, with more analysis for the near future to establish what the correct obstacle detection system would be for a heavy rail application. Now, what we also see in the automotive sector is that there are decent processes that are established for autonomous vehicles. Something which is differing if it's either in Europe or in the US, but I believe that the processes that are in place are actually facilitating the innovation in the sector. And I think that's something which is not necessarily true for the railway sector currently. What you see in the automotive sector is that it's a heavily focused approach around learning by doing, failing fast, and closely monitoring what's happening in pilots and feeding that back into the legislation. So that even led to legislation that has now been changed and is in place to allow for testing and maybe even commercial use of autonomous vehicles currently. So, for example, the Experimenteerwet, experimental law in the Netherlands, is a good example of that. That has been developed because of the applications and pilots that were going on with autonomous vehicles. In railway, in contrast, I think a full demonstration of safety is always needed up front. And it's something that I already discussed previously. It's really hard to showcase in the case of automation of such a complex environment, a complex system. And also the application process remains much more opaque, with no single counter that takes ownership, compared to the Experimenteerwet, where there's a clear point of contact, a clear counter where you can apply for a pilot with such a system. So a good example, I think, that applies here is the Rivian Park shuttle, which has been operational since 1999 near the Rotterdam area in the Netherlands. And it's been operational in commercial use, actually, for quite a while now, and has been proven quite safe since, and it's servicing a business park that would have otherwise been completely cut off from public transport and is now serviced by the metro system together with this autonomous shuttle. So a good application that is benefiting from a much more clear system. What we also see is vehicle-to-vehicle communication that's relevant for the railway sector. I believe that ultimately vehicle-to-vehicle communication will lead us to even more capacity in the railways, which we really think we will need in the future. And that will enable us, according to several studies out there, to potentially reduce the headway further up to 11 seconds on high-speed lines. And this technology is already available. Direct vehicle-to-vehicle technology is tested in truck platooning, for example. The right-hand figure here is from our personal archive, where I was in a truck driving at highway speeds, 80, 90 kilometers per hour, at only a time gap of 0.3 seconds. So that's really quite daunting in the beginning when you're stepping into the cab, but eventually when you grow accustomed to technology and that you feel that the technology is working properly and the safety mitigations are in place, you really get used to such technology quite rapidly. Unfortunately, there's quite a lot of debate on safety implementations of virtual coupling technology, of platooning on the railways. But there are some examples of shift-to-rail projects that are piloting such technology. I think the key here is that we can use technology from other sectors that is, well, focused more around direct vehicle-to-vehicle technology rather than looking only at 5G developments and the centralized backbone that needs to be developing. Because I believe that if you bring together these vehicles more closely, it becomes very relevant to have short delays in the system. And that's facilitated by using direct vehicle-to-vehicle technology. So something we can maybe learn from other sectors and really focusing on debate on why is this not possible in the railways. So to come back to our statement in the beginning, that we believe that the extreme safety standards hinder innovation and are chasing passengers into innovative cars, eventually increasing the total amount of fatalities overall in transportation. Something we might discuss a little bit further in the next few slides. So we showed you in the beginning already that there's an increase in demand for the railways that is predicted and that's already seen compared to previous years. And that's even looking at an increase in road transport that's higher than rail and also for aviation. So if we want to create a model shift towards rail, want to be more attractive, that's going to cause an even greater increase in demand. But what if we fail to meet that demand? What's going to happen and how does that translate into the safety of our overall transportation system? So for this, I had a look at the UK figures that were available for 2017. Where 80 billion kilometers was traveled on the railways and 681 billion for road transport. So that's quite a factor that we also see in the other figures. Of course, road transport is a lot bigger still. What we also see in the Foresight study that the UK has published is that a annual increase of about 2.6% is predicted over the next couple of years. So looking at the current level of fatalities that's also available, but this was calculated from the figures that we showed you earlier from the EU level. This would mean that 80 billion kilometers of transport would translate into about 3 fatalities per year for the railways. Similarly, with a factor 10, about a factor 10 more kilometers, the automotive domain translates into 1975 fatalities. And these are calculated rates, but they're actually quite close to the verified actual rates that were published for 2017. Actually, both were a little bit lower, 0 for rail and about 1700 for automotive. But this shows you that really it's quite skewed. The number of fatalities that we should have in railways is much, much lower than the number of fatalities that you see in road transport. And if we take that idea and translate that to what happens if we fail to meet demand. If we fail to create that extra capacity, then eventually all those people that might be on our railway system will step into their cars. So that means that 2% of all these people will be driving their cars, creating accidents, creating fatalities. This translates into about 6 extra fatalities if we fail to achieve that on a yearly basis for just these extra passengers. But if we succeed, well, we may end up becoming a little bit less safe than we are right now, because we demonstrated that we really are quite safe as a transportation system compared to other modes of transportation. So let's say we do achieve extra capacity, but we do become less safe in the process. Let's say 10 times less safe, which I really doubt if that will be the case. So that would mean eventually, if those people step into rail, that means only about 1 extra fatality compared to what we have these days. It's quite significant, but overall, compared to 0 extra road fatalities, that means we would be saving about 5 lives by increasing the capacity of our transportation system. So overall, even if we become less safe in the process, because we have to be innovative, because we have to create capacity, increasing capacity for our railway system and getting people on board would still save lives, even if we become less safe. So that said, we can become less safe maybe, but we do need to tackle the question of safety. So I already showed that the current system of safety demonstration is a little bit challenging because we need to demonstrate everything up front, and it's very challenging to know all the unknown unknowns and test for it. But what if we could change that approach? What if that would align better with the inherent uncertainty of the current emerging technologies? So at Ricardo, we believe that that future of proving safety, of learning algorithms, it's different. We might not be able to demonstrate everything up front anymore, but we need to show that it's safe with a closed loop. So what we suggest we do is that we monitor the real world behavior of the vehicles. And we can do that with data that's already sort of available, but we need to gather the data of the vehicles that are driving out there and compare that to a vehicle that we believe is behaving safe on the roads today. And that can be relating to speed limits, to distance keeping, traffic crossing, red lights, anything that we feel is safe or not safe. And with the technology that's available right now, with big data, with monitoring solutions, I believe that we can create a solution that allows us to start small, scale up, and keep a closed loop happening all the time to make sure that these vehicles are as safe as we like them to be and keep improving all the time as well. So this would allow us to put these vehicles on the road much faster than would be the case today if we want to prove everything up front. So, arriving to our conclusion. We believe in this presentation and in our paper as well, we've shown that safety and innovation do not always easily go hand in hand. It's challenging, and it's challenging times that we're looking at. But remaining passive is also a choice, with societal effects as illustrated. It will have effects if we decide to stay where we are right now and let people go on board of other transportation modes. Eventually, we believe that adding capacity at the cost of some safety would save lives. And I highly doubt it that we would reduce our safety level with 10 times if we would allow ourselves some more innovation. So, what we believe is that we should be striving for innovation, that we need to be looking at other sectors, that we need to embrace innovation in the railway much more than we have in the past, and that it would enable us to eventually get more people in the railways and provide a much better safety level than the competing transportations are doing right now or might be delivering in the near future. So, after what we showed you in our lecture today and what's written in our paper, our question to you is this. Would the railways maybe not be just a little bit too safe? And that's something we would like to discuss with you about. I hope we have showed you some new thoughts, some new ideas that will enable us to meet up with the capacity challenges of the future and keep railway a really competitive and attractive mode of transportation in the future. So if you're viewing this live, there will be a Q&A added on to this lecture in a minute that we'll be happy to take your questions in. If you're reviewing this at another time, please feel free to reach out to us by email or LinkedIn, for example, and we'll be happy to discuss any thoughts on what we've showed you today, or maybe any relevant thoughts on what's happening out there in the world as well. So thank you for your attention today. It was a pleasure to show what we've seen in the world and what we've seen in our projects. And I hope that our lecture will provide food for thought on how we can approach the railways of the future and keep our mode of transportation competitive and relevant. Thank you.